Sarah, thank you for a great presentation, I appreciate it. On Dirk Fingry, I live about a half a mile further out on Herrick Road. I'm confused about the water. You talk about the amount of water that flows over the dam and use that as a metric, and yet you drill wells down into an aquifer below. It seems to me that those are unconnected in my mind. So can you help me understand how those two interact and play?
It's Mike Abbott from Ransom Consulting.
Yeah, sure, that's actually a great question. And I don't think I really explained that as well as I should have, but, okay, and I don't want to take too long to answer this question, but you're right. All the water that falls, it starts off as rain, falls into the watershed. Some of it goes in the ground, some of it goes in the stream, some of it is taken up by plants and grass and everything. Some of it evaporates off the surface of the reservoirs, for instance, or off the ground. The groundwater, and in this case we're talking specifically about the bedrock aquifer, which is the fractures in the bedrock, the water flows through those. That's what we're tapping into when we drill the wells. So that, you're right, it's in the ground, it's not flowing in the river or over the dam necessarily, but as you move down through the watershed from the higher elevations to lower elevations, groundwater follows that slope, and it does eventually discharge. Shallow groundwater will discharge to some of the local tributaries and streams. It's called base flow. So part of a river or stream's flow is groundwater discharging into it. Because the water doesn't really flow across and underneath streams. It comes from the high elevations down and into the streams and discharges. But to answer your question, you're absolutely right. Not all of the water coming through the watershed flows over that dam. There's some portion, especially where we are in the very lower point of the watershed, that just continues to flow in the groundwater system and will eventually discharge into the bay. So you're right, not all, but that 15,000 gallons a minute that I mentioned, that's what's coming over the dam at the end of the watershed, but there is a small, some portion of the water that would continue to flow at bedrock and out into the bay. So we're taking some of that. Now, when you pump, you may influence the hydraulic boundaries like the streams and cause some of that water to flow back in, but it's a very small percentage. Most of what we're taking out is what's in the bedrock already moving toward the ocean.
So I have a question about the sustainability. You're doing the water testing now, and in the past two summers, we've had droughts. So how about testing again in the summer to ensure that, I mean, they've been relatively short droughts. We've been very fortunate. So
yes, good question, another good question. Yes, last year was a dry year, and the year before that was even worse. It was one of our worst droughts in quite a while. Part of the assessment I'm working on, the model that I've discussed, when we run those scenarios, we simulate the wells pumping out over long terms. We also run what's called the drought scenario, where one of the inputs to the model is recharge, which is precipitation infiltrating into the groundwater. And so we reduce that by 40% for a sustained period of time. We assume like a 3-year sustained drought. So imagine 3 years like the year before last. And so that's part of the analysis. So I've done that for this site. You're right that we pumped out one point in the year. So it was in this early spring. We probably didn't have much water in the whole system as we have right now that we've got a lot of rain. So our low flow times of year are the middle of the winter when everything's frozen and you're not getting any infiltration, and then near the end of summer in a dry year especially. Based on a 3 or 4 day test, you have to make some assumptions in predicting everything out, and we did take that into account.
Can you answer a follow-up question to that? Are you going to be testing again in the the summer, so I'm thinking that, so I think that maybe somebody in that.
Yes, part of, I mean, part of the overall plan to develop this site, and just in terms of the wells, which is my part of this, as as I mentioned, we drill test wells, we ran hydraulic tests on those. As we install the actual production wells, we will have to test each one of those individually, partly so we know exactly what the sustainable yield of each well is, and we know what depth we should set our pumps, a lot of things like that, what size pump we should be in. But that's also part of that, would be part of the permitting process, I would imagine. And so I guess it's certainly wouldn't be a bad idea to run those tests in the driest time of the year, because that's going to give us the worst case scenario. And I have worked on other water supply projects where that's part of the testing process is to run the hydraulic tests, in a spell of dry weather. It doesn't always work out the way you hope, but that's because it always seems to rain as soon as you try to run the test. But certainly, that will give us the worst case for an individual well test, and then we could use that data again to refine our models.
My name is Joanne Mosswild, and I live on Lower Congress Street, not too far from where you went and did the project. I have a lot of questions about the components of the food, where it's going to come from, what it's going to be made of, and if there are any toxins in it. And also, how does that, when you feed the fish, affect the nutritional quality of the product?
Here's Eric Heim of Northern Aqua Farms.
So I guess we can have a long discussion about this. So the sourcing of the feed will be in Maine. There are a number of feed suppliers in Maine, in this region. So we established early dialogue with them in terms of non-GMO agreements, potential organic feed products in the market. All these exist in various forms. And one of the interesting things about the feed supply market is that you can also customize feeds if you buy sufficient volumes. So typically fish feeds have components, and it varies from feed to feed, on vegetable proteins, they may be fish meal, fish oil. There's a lot of work happening in terms of substitutes. Obviously for the reason that as the sector grows, you don't want to be emptying the ocean out to feed other fish. So some of the big things that I think I mentioned are the most interesting ones, I believe, and that will be evolving is insect production in mass scale. It's a very logical feed ingredient. And also a lot of research going into various algae products that are going to be coming in as potential substitutes. So the challenge, I think, for the entire feed industry is that both trout and salmon are carnivore fish. So they will have major gut problems if you only feed them plant protein. So that's the interesting research challenge that's going on now. A lot of research is being done on this. So our goal in Maine is to try to source as much as we can regional, sustainable feed ingredients. We have not concluded on it. We're not using feed, at least for another year. So we have plenty of time to work with the feed suppliers and explore what options they have available in this region. So that's the answer I can give at this point. But it's an important issue. Yeah.
Yes, thank you so much for this presentation. Really appreciate it. I'm Kristen Robinson from Belfast. And my question is a follow-up, I guess, for Mr. Ransom about the water. You said that what I've been hearing is that Nordic Aqua Farms will need 1,200 gallons of fresh water per minute, and that there is, according to your most recent tests coming over the dam, 1,500 gallons per minute. That only leaves, did I miss it?
15,000.
Oh, 15,000. Never mind.
Thank you.
I'm Phyllis Quillo from Belfast. I was wondering if there happened to be some sort of bacterial problem in the tank, or some other toxin, or just some sickness with the fish. What do you do about that?
Okay, so one of the benefits of a well-run land-based farm is that you can reduce your risk of this, but you, with any animal production, are never risk-free. So our main, from our perspective, our main concern is to be able to treat the water that we get in from the bay, because most of the water we're using will be seawater, and that's the major source of risk for getting disease. So in our case, we are using a number of steps to prevent this. First of all, is just taking our particles is step one. Step two is flocculant treatment as a natural flocculant developed from shrimp shells, among other things, that attracts and binds a lot of material, including bacteria and virus. And the final step is UV treatment, which is a known method for neutralizing bacteria. So prevention is perhaps the most important part of it. The other source you can get from disease is the fish you get into your system. And that's why quarantine in the first steps is very important. So you have contained first steps from egg to the first fish fry stage and so on. And that means that if there's any genetic reason whatsoever that some fish develop disease, you can stop that in an earlier phase before it sprays into your production. So all these steps, and this is why knowledge and experienced people is so important, because if you make mistakes, you can get in trouble. So beyond that, beyond all those reasons, if for whatever reason you should get disease in your facility, it really depends what it is. In some cases, it can be managed through various methods and means. In a very, very worst case scenario, you would take out your fish and grind it up and recycle it for various uses or purposes. Still a high protein resource. So in Norway, they have very strict routines for these things. And those are practices that we've been looking at, how the US government and authorities also will be regulating these things if you have disease and mortalities. But I can say, in a typical facility like we have in Denmark, we have mortalities under 2%. And a lot of those are also natural causes, it's not caused by disease. So every facility is required to have procedures to deal with any situation where you get mortality increases if you should get lucky and get disease. And we're in the same situation as any animal producer. Any animal producer can get disease, and this is the response you have to that and how you deal with it that needs to be in place before you start producing. So I hope that partly answers the question.
Thank you. My name is Debbie Smith. I live in Belfast. I've observed at least one well in the upper reservoir. I'm wondering if you can explain the purpose of those wells and if you have plans to use the upper reservoir. Thank you.
We did, in fact, install a couple of wells up in the upper reservoir. And part of that was just to get a greater understanding of the watershed as a whole. Obviously, you know, as Mike explained earlier, it's a large area, and the more information we have, the better we're able to make assumptions about how it's going to behave and predict how it might behave in the future if we do withdrawals. There is no plan to use wells in the upper reservoir. Those wells will ultimately be removed so that the folks walking the path up there won't see them along the side of the path. But we don't have any plans at the moment to be developing that as a water source.
Hello, I'm Brendan Brown of Montville.
I gotta say, I'm not super clear on the graphs with the filtered discharge and unfiltered discharge. It wasn't obvious to me what process you're talking about, and if it's the same byproducts that you're talking about that are nutrient-rich and there's a marketplace for that. Based on what you said, you wanted to differentiate your brand by getting this lower number, which indicates that you're taking a loss by doing the extra filtering despite the fact that you sell the byproduct. I just wish that, would you elaborate a little bit on what those graphs are telling us?
I can try.
Thanks.
So if you look at the history of this industry, 100% is destroyed of all nutrients, feed pieces. Copper treatment of sea cages, everything is discharged into the ocean. That's the history of this industry. And that's the point is, like I was trying to say, is that in this case scenario, for a land-based producer, you can pretty much influence and decide what you want to let into your facility and what you want to let out of your facility. So in the case of the discharge here, the starting point is really the same discharge as a CPET. That's the left-hand column you saw. That's what we would be discharging if we weren't doing any interventions. If you look in Europe right now, regulation regarding discharge is becoming stricter and stricter. And that means the industry needs to respond to this. And it's typically phosphorus is perhaps the most important focus area due to its potential effects for algae growth if you have large releases in areas. So these technologies that we are applying here is not something invented by us. So in the solids, for example, suspended solids, it's what's called drum filters, belt filters that take out all the suspended solids of the water as the water passes through and are gathered up into basically a residual water product that has 1 to 2% dry matter, which would be that sludge. And the next step is to dewater it into more powdery form. So that's taking directly out of your discharge. While the remaining water, where this is removed, will be your discharge. So the little residual you have of suspended solids are the very, very, very fine particular matter that these filters cannot capture. And that's the remaining 1%. So in terms of, and there's a different treatment process for every one of these things. So for example, for phosphorus, it's a two-step process where you would basically do also a treatment with so-called aluminate. There's a number of different ways of doing this. It's being applied by many US companies to remove phosphorus from the discharge, because there's many, many things that produce phosphorus today. Anything from your toothpaste to your to detergent, it's everywhere. So these technologies are known and they're applied, and it's just a matter of complying with any law that is in the country or region you are in. And beyond that, it's up to the producer to decide if they want to do more. And there is a cost to that, but there's also a benefit to be had in terms of a sustainability profile and brand. My personal clear opinion is that sustainable, socially responsible companies in the future will be the winners in the food industry. And we want to be one of them. So that's just some examples. I don't know if you had further questions, but.
So we have one question.
Yeah, I'd be happy to Steve talk to you after the meeting. Yeah.
Hi, I'm Ron Huber, friends of Penobscot Bay. I live in Rockland. And I have sort of a double question. One is, there was a mention of salinity in the lower well near the shore. Was that something that occurred during the drilling, during the test pumping? In other words, was salt water intruding in, or was it already intruded in?
I'll try and answer that. So we didn't actually get to salt water. So we drilled, and there's a certain amount of variability in salinity as you measure, even in a what would be ordinarily thought of as a purely freshwater well, you are going to have some variability in your measurements. We did not, even after 3 days of pumping, enter into what we would consider to be a brackish or saline well. I think what Mike's graph was really just showing you is that there is a tidal cycle that we were observing while pumping that well in terms of the pattern. And if we would consider a saltwater environment to be I think it would be what, 32-ish, we were maybe at 4, so less than 1, yeah, okay. So we were not even close to being in anything that we would consider a salt environment.
Jerry Brand, I live here in Belfast, and I've got a geek question for you. If you think about salmon as a protein conversion system, how many pounds of saleable fish do you get for each pound of feed, or the reverse? What's the range in that?
So the conversion ratio, just to explain that, for salmon is approximately 1 pound of feed for 1 pound of fish. If you want to convert that to a gutted fish, you take out 20%. So if you go to beef or other products, that ratio is completely different. You lose a lot more biomass. So it's widely recognized as the most efficient feed conversion animal to farm in the world today. That's the benefit of fish. And that's why also the international environmental authorities are pointing to fish as perhaps the most important species to be farming in the future due to its sustainability. But that also involves that the industry as a whole needs to be working more and more with sustainability standards in terms of all the things we discussed today. We think we are addressing a lot of them, and there's still more exciting stuff to be happening here. So, but that's the answer to your question.
I'm Shelley Swanson-Fine from Northport, and want to also thank you for this presentation. My questions have to do with the added value to the Belfast area. I'm assuming you're going to look to hire local people, and also we have a salmon processing plant here. They have to import their salmon to process. Is there any chance you can hook up with our salmon processing plant?
Well, to answer your question, we were there today and met with the plant manager. So you had a couple of questions. We are starting our early employment in the U.S. perspective. We happen to be starting here in Maine. So my hope is that we will find a good lot of employees from the local area if they want to work for us. We will also be importing employees because some of these positions we're talking about requires a long experience, and we hope to be also recruiting college graduates from Maine. There are a number of programs that are relevant to what we're doing. So we're hoping for a nice bouquet of local employees, U.S. national employees, and maybe a few international ones also. If you look at our operations in Norway, it's also international. We brought an employee from British Columbia to Norway. So I hope and think that that will form the basis for, you know, a bustling, exciting aquaculture community here in Belfast and the region, right? So in terms of duck trap, which I'm assuming you're referring to, we had a very nice meeting there today with the plant manager and the CEO over there. They seem to be interested in local supply, and we did discuss many of the benefits of the product. We did discuss it in the context of a number of the customers they have and the potential benefits. I don't feel I can go into detail about what they said, but they happen to be a Norwegian-owned company as well, in case you didn't know this. And so I feel we hit it off in a very good tone, and it's something we will follow up in the future and see where that can lead us. We will be positive to finding cooperation with them.
I'm Sid Quarrier. I live in Appleton. Since seawater is an important part of this, the Gulf of Maine is not a static joint these days. It's going through profound changes, and both the magnitude and trajectory of those changes are really not clearly understood. And with that change are changes to the plankton of all sorts in the bay. So my question is, as the future issues around plankton are simply unclear, is the plankton filtered out of and what parts of plankton are filtered out of your system and can changes in plankton or even toxins or die-offs affect what you have to discharge or how you run your plant?
That's a broad topic. Just to make clear, we don't use toxins in the facility. So there's no discharge of any toxin. And that relates also to the chemicals and medication side that I touched on. So in terms of, to be honest, I don't know the whole plankton community, you might say, in the Bay. And I don't know what potential issues. What we are concerned about is a lot of the things that are happening in the ocean, like you're mentioning. And we are following very closely developments that may be happening along the coastline here in terms of oxygen depletion, plastic, microplastic problems, climate change, many of the issues. As far as our discharge in this case, or the intake, it's an insignificant amount of water compared to what's in the Bay. So it's inconceivable for me to think that it would have any impact whatsoever. And the other piece of that is also that, you know, if there are discussions, issues going on in the community about ocean conditions, anything we can get engaged in, we'd be happy to do that, just so you know that.
My name is David Tannhauser. I live in Waldo. When you said there are no antibiotics routinely used, does that include antifungals also?
Fungus?
Antifungals.
No. So what we've seen generally is there are aquaculture producers working with freshwater, also for grow-out operations. What we've seen there in many cases is that you can get more fungal problems, but we're not doing that. So typically the treatment for fungal will be salt. So those who are producing with fresh water, they have applied salt to treat fungal problems. So there's no medication involved in that, should you get that.
Yeah, some of my question relates to, my name is Jim Merkel. I live here in Belfast. And some of my questions relate to process, but also to like trustability and sustainability. I teach sustainability and I've written books about it. I study life cycle analysis, and when you put up a number of 1/3 the energy of shipped salmon, I need to know, is that a full life cycle analysis, including glass, steel, inputs, outputs, and also things that are hard to quantify, but also I want to know how we can trust sustainability. For example, my son and I went to walk the site, and we just were curious. So we had out our GPS, and we came across this really mucked up area that led us all the way to the test drill. And I have cut the trees for my own land to build a house, but you never go on land with any machine unless it's frozen or it's stable. That's just, it's in the main, you know, it's just common sense, and it's also in the law. But we came across the creek that had logs piled in the creek to, allow you to cross it with the machinery. So I want to know, and then we saw all the sediment in the creek, but then my son and I went to look where the creek hadn't been disturbed. These are the little, along the Little River Trail, and you can see the creek is a beautiful little creek compared to your creek near your, where you breached it, completely choked with sediment. And you know, we're just wondering sustainability. I want to know, like, okay, you didn't involve us in the process, you can't, you know, two info sessions without real good public comment. We had a public session with the city, overwhelming opposition, and the next day in the paper, it's like, oh, there was no problem. We got our next green stamp is on your website. And I'm sitting here, I teach this stuff for 30 years. I'm not a newcomer to sustainability. I've never found a sustainable monoculture in my life. And I, you know, I teach this stuff. We teach caged, we won't feed my family caged. It's torture fish to me. This is torture, you know, but it's like, that's an ethical component. Around the college campuses, we're talking cage-free, humane treatment, fair wages, all these things. And we were talking bring back our fisheries, have local, organic. All these things are missing here. Like, everything I teach at the university in sustainability is missing, and I want to hear
how you paint this as sustainability when it's completely opposite what I've been teaching for 30 years.
I'll comment on the first part, and then I'll let Eric take it from there. So, this winter, as many of you know, wasn't typical. We had a pretty good thaw rate in February, which is not typical. And that's right when a number of the investigations were going on. That's why we invited Maine DEP out to the site to look at what we were doing for sediment control. But I'll also point out that we were primarily traveling on existing wood roads. So that log bridge you were referring to, that's been there for before our time on site. A number of the, a good chunk of the property had a series of existing logging roads, and we tried as best we could to use those for a number of reasons, but also to help minimize that impact. And yes, this was a freeze-thaw cycle, and there was mud. But I think those of you who walk the trails will find that there's already been an effort to reseed and hay areas that were disturbed. If you go up along the upper reservoir, for example, you can see where the water district has already laid out hay to help things reseed. And we've done a pretty sizable job to try to make sure that the impacts are temporary and are mitigated. I'll let Eric speak maybe some more to the overall question of sustainability.
We fired the guy who did this on their own land.
Okay.
Who worked in the rain.
Jim, we're asking for an environment of mutual respect and civility, and really what the protocol is for today is one question per person. Thank you, Jim.
Well, I appreciate you showing us, so I mean, we appreciate getting feedback on these things, so obviously, there are many things happening, and my understanding is DEP was involved and so on, but in terms of sustainability, I think it's really a matter of where you're coming from. What we're doing is widely recognized as one of the most sustainable ways of producing fish and volume today by many, many environmental organizations. But it depends on where you're coming from and what your alternative is. So. So I don't know if I can take the discussion any further than that at this point, but I'd be happy to speak to you afterwards. You know, we can have a discussion about it.
About the one-third number.
What, and one-third what? Yes, okay, so this is scientifically documented between the SINTEF in Norway Research Institution and the Freshwater Institute in the U.S., a cooperation project where they're taking all the different CO2 components from construction, concrete, everything, put the and operations and shipment, and put it together in an equation showing the CO2 component of a fish to market. And they're not taking into account, for example, what's your source of energy? Is it coal or is it renewable energies? And they're taking all these dimensions into account. And based upon that, they have estimated the CO2 output to the end customer, for example, for a land-based product, based upon renewable, more green energy sources, which is coal powered. And then they've taken a CPEN product coming from Norway to the US, air freighted fresh, and compared that. So air freighted fresh to the US, for example, Norway is 15 kilos equivalent CO2. A land-based product in the US, milked in a land-based farm, is approximately 5. There can be variations from product to project to project, depending on how you construct it, your local energy supply, many things like that. But it's, you can look it up. The Whitewater Institute in the Freshwater Institute in the US has been involved in the study.
So I would just, before you speak, I'd like to remind everyone that we are hoping for one question per person. This is not a time for personal testimony. There will be additional hearings in the future for public comment. And so in an environment of mutual respect and civility, we ask for one question per person.
Hi, I'm Rhonda Kahn and I live in Belfast. And I want to go back to the discharge into the bay. because I'm not clear about it. I do appreciate the charts, and I'm glad that you're going to go the extra level and the extra mile to create less sludge. But I'm still not clear about what the impact of that sludge discharge will be on our bay. I'm not an oceanographer. I don't know offhand what the tides are and how the currents work. I don't know where that's going. Is it going to go back to Norway? Is it going to London? Is it going to Rockland? Is it and so is it going to change the temperature? Is it going to sit on the bottom of our bay and change that whole ecosystem in ways we don't know? So that's the question I have.
Yeah, okay. Well, first of all, we are not discharging the sludge. Okay? So okay. Again, this is captured, dewatered, and it's a waste resource that has a value. So it's a very, very small amount that's not filtered out. And if you compare it to the agriculture runoff and everything else going into the bay, it's like a needle in a haystack. We looked at the other permits in the area as well that's been given for environmental permits. I don't know if you do you have any perspective on that?
I can say a little bit.
So first of all, you do raise obviously an interesting point about where does it go? The Belfast Bay is a complex bay system, and although there are a number of studies that have been done modeling and measuring the currents in the bay, there's nothing that's yet specific to right in the area where this discharge pipe would ultimately go. So part of that is a question that we hope to continue to research ourselves in terms of understanding where do we need to put that endpoint to minimize the impact and maximize the dispersion of what water does come down that pipe. And so we'll be taking additional measurements and doing additional current modeling to study the exact point of where this pipe will go. So hopefully in a future meeting, we'll have additional information to provide for you. But I think one of the things that is just to put it in context for people, is I think Erica showed you earlier the graph of phosphorus, and there's this big, tall, here's what it could be, and here's what we're taking it down to. That, what he takes it down to, that 6 pounds of phosphorus per day, is the same as about 10 to 15 lawns in the neighborhood and what that discharges from the grass. And that's not even somebody who's using a lot of fertilizer. That's just simply what's coming off of grass through rainwater. So thinking in terms of that, it is really a small number that ultimately is going out into the bay itself. And I hope that helps.
My name is Mary Bigelow. I'm from Belfast. I have a fairly narrow question. If you're raising your fish in salt water, isn't the manure saline? And how can you make a salt-free product from salty manure?
Are you thinking about the sludge?
The sludge.
Right, okay. So typically, it depends on the purpose we finally end up applying that to. So there are a number of different directions we can take with a sludge resource. Mm-hmm. So in Norway, there's a number of different directions also the industry is using, depending on the location, what the market is. If you're looking for a soil enhancement product, you will typically mix it up with other biological materials.
Okay.
So it will be, so that's obviously, this is something we're starting a study on in Maine to understand the various market opportunities in Maine or a type of end product or process that will be optimal for Maine. And there are a number of different directions we can take. So I hope not too far into this year that we will have some more specific directions that we can point to with the partner that we're gonna be working with this on. So it's an exciting area that I hope can return some value back to some industry sector in this state.
Hi, I'm Leslie Miller from Belfast, and I'm glad to hear that you're talking to Duck Trap. But I find myself on Route 1 many times a week. And it's a horror story. And you have all these trucks coming in, and you have all these trucks going out. And has anybody thought that it's going to create a complete impossibility?
I'll try and answer that a little bit. So as you know, we have a long road ahead of us in the permitting process. There are town permits that we need to go through, as well as state permits that we need to go through. And one of those larger permitting things ahead of us is to evaluate impacts to the overall community. So things like noise, things like traffic. And so obviously the first thing we start with is studying the existing traffic patterns and looking at what is going up and down Route 1, what's coming in and out of side streets, what does it look like to try and merge onto Route 1, and then looking at what are the truck traffic trips that would be coming in and out of the facility. I think, if I'm not mistaken, Eric, that's 10, about a dozen trips per day. And then the impact, obviously, of employees coming in and out of the facility. So in the process of doing that, you develop a sound plan for how you're going to get the traffic from the facility to be a minimal impact on what's already there. I can't do much about summer traffic coming up Route 1, but we can hope to minimize the additional impact that we have from the facility.
Hi, my name is Lawrence Reichert. I'm a resident of Belfast. And Mr. Hines said that there would be no escapage from the facility. And just for the benefit of the public here, the reason that's important is that the land-based fish will be less hardy than the open water fish. And they will then breed, if they are able to escape, they will breed with the open water fish. And that will make the offspring less hardy. It's also important because they compete with the open water fish for spawning grounds, and they destroy the spawning grounds of open water fish. Now, Mr. Hine said earlier that there would be zero escapage from this, but I spoke with a Dr. Anders Carlson Drangsholt of the Bellon Foundation in Norway, and he said that no matter how secure anyone thinks their facility is, there is a known problem of fish escapage from indoor facilities. Double barriers can't prevent this altogether, especially because there are tears in the water outlet filters that especially fish in their younger stages, when they're smaller, can escape through. Can you please comment on that?
Sure. So you have barriers inside the actual production models, a number of barriers, screen barriers. And then the water goes out to external final treatment, discharge treatment. So in essence, for it to have an escape, you would have the fish swimming through about 6-7 physical barriers, which all would have to fail at the same time. So what I can say is, you can probably come up with a theoretical case where it can happen, but what we can say for sure is that the risk is tremendously reduced compared to a seabed production. That's what I can say to you.
My name is Alicia Gallero. I'm a resident of Belfast. I'm also a college student at the University of Maine Farmington. I actually wanted to directly reference the life cycle analysis that you described. Paper. So I would like to have you speak to the economic viability of this project, because in that paper it's cited that a comparative analysis of the recirculating aquaculture systems to net pen farms, and it found that the capital costs are 80% higher for recirculating aquaculture systems, and that the production costs are 10% higher. And then the most significant finding of this, and these are of farms in equal in size or equal in scale, that open net pen farms see twice the return on investment, even when the recirculating aquaculture system salmon is sold at a 30% price premium to that of the net pen produced salmon. Obviously, I'm not against this project in any way personally in terms of the environmental impact, but I just am curious about the long-term viability and sustainability in order to be competitive in the market.
Sure. So there's several questions in terms of investment costs.
when you look at the cost of getting permits and setting up a CFAN operation today, if you wanted to buy one CFAN permit, the total cost of that is higher than an equal production amount to build a land-based facility today, if you do it right in the right location. Historically, the challenge has been facilities have been small, so, and that's why you're seeing bigger and bigger facilities, because there's a certain scale advantage you need to get to be capital efficient. So as of today, the investment community in Norway, and us, it's also being more and more seen in the US, is that they're almost equal in capital efficiency in terms of investment levels. It's changed a lot in recent years. It's a very rapid development. In terms of production cost, again, if you are at the right location, executing your business and your production properly, you are seeing cost parity in production costs more or less today. And part of the reason for that is that CFAN production costs have more than doubled in the last 70 years. So it's a very different picture just a few years ago. So it's a rapid development. So this is why you were seeing a lot of capital moving around this now, because suddenly capital cost is in the same range, production cost in the same range. So in our case, we're not assuming a large premium in the long term, because to be viable, it has to be competitive. And in the end, it's a matter of limitations in number of CFAN locations, and that means that to be able to increase local supply, you have to think in new ways. And this is one of the avenues that is attracting a lot of interest right now, because they're seeing it in dozens and dozens of farms in Norway, small and small land-based farms, and also a number of farms in Europe now, that production is viable. But you're right, if you have a small farm, you're gonna struggle with financial viability. You need scale. So I hope that partly answers your question. But as many, I probably have 10, 15 students proposing a study every month comparing CPAN and land-based farming. It's a very, very popular topic, for sure.
So it's 7:37, so we'll take two more questions. Okay. So we'll have two more questions. So and then I know there are more questions that people have, and staff will be available for a few minutes after, and they can also be contacted from Dora Balcofarms from Ransom Consulting. And then, as always, you can connect with myself or city councilors by email or by phone or by coming to a meeting.
I'm Marta Frisardi. I don't live in Belfast. I live in Thomaston. But I came up here because I read the article in the Free Press. And I want to know more about the jobs that the plant will be offering, because I would like to know if you would be willing to partner with the University of Maine and perhaps tell us what types of skills you would like those students to have. As someone who teaches genetics and microbiology, I'd like to know, because I'm ready if you are.
Thank you. Well, I can tell you that we have a great partnership with the Norwegian University of Life Sciences, which happens to be just 30 minutes away from our Norwegian site. One of the, they have multiple interests. One of them is, of course, research. So we have a fairly large environmental grant in Norway, which they are part of. But the other part they've been interested in is recruitment of students to marine sciences. And they realize that these kinds of projects does attract a lot of interest, student interest. So in terms of Maine, we would love to be in contact. We've had some contacts here and there, but we haven't really engaged yet. There are internship opportunities, obviously recruitment opportunities. We'd love to have the young generation of Mainers coming from universities, coming to learn the business and be a part of it in the future. So I hope we have a chance to discuss that more. Yeah.
My name's Armandy McFadden, and I own the aquaculture site just downstream to where you're supposed to be dumping that water and whatever else is in it. I haven't heard anything today about the nitrogen content in the water, and I'd like to know what you propose to do if an algae bloom starts on my aquaculture site, as well as the rest of the bay around here, And are you also aware that 90% of the world's eels come through the Penobscot Bay to spawn here? And there's over 18 species that will be directly impacted. And how often do you plan on checking those traps in your pipe?
Okay. So in terms of nitrogen, we are taking out 60% of that. That leaves it at 1,600 pounds a day, which is well within the permits that have been given in this area before for other businesses. And I think the important thing is that if we are discharging far offshore with a very efficient spreading when we finalize the pinpointing of that. Well, we are looking at probably, to get to the appropriate depth where we want to be, we're probably looking at a mile, plus minus. I'm not sure what your site is, but certainly we could have a discussion about that. So if you look at the total nitrogen discharge that probably goes into this bay, this is small in the end. And you will not find any land-based fish producer taking out more than that we are taking out in this case. So that's the best answer I can give right now.
So I would like to thank you all again for being here tonight. We're gonna conclude the question and answer. And as I mentioned, staff will be here for a few minutes after this session. I will still be here, and you can connect with city council members by email.